This is Vermont Edition. I'm Michaela Lefrak. Video games aren't just a fun thing to do at home, by yourself, or with friends. Gaming is a big business that draws big crowds to competitions, showcases, and increasingly, movies and TV shows based off of popular games. Today on the show, we're going to be looking at gaming in our region. It's a topic we hit on about a year ago in a show we did on esports, and a lot's happened since then. And we're also trying something new today. We are streaming today's show on Twitch. If you haven't heard of it, it's a live streaming platform that a lot of gamers use to interact with viewers. We'll be taking questions in the regular way, calls and emails, but also from viewers on Twitch. Later in the hour, we're going to be joined by a game production professor at Champlain College in Burlington and an esports training center for kids and teens in Essex Junction. But first, I'm joined in the studio by my colleague, Bryant Denton. By day, he works on our station's digital team. He also reports on video game culture for NPR. Bryant, welcome.
Hello. Hello. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we're glad you're here. So how long have you been into video games? How long have you been playing?
I mean, it's hard to answer, you know. I want to say as long as I can remember, you know. But we had a Sega Genesis growing up, then you get a new console, an N64, a PlayStation. It all kind of blends together. You don't know exactly where it starts. Mm. But probably one of the games that I remember have like the most fond memories of starting is a game called Diablo 2 that came out in 2000. So at least since 2000.
All right, so that's what really got you hooked.
Yeah.
And today, you're going to be sharing some reporting you did on a specific genre in the world of video games, around horror. Tell us more. Yeah. Why is this of interest?
Yeah. Well, how I began to start covering horror was NPR started doing some reporting around games a couple years ago, and they just said, "Hey, will you play these games?" And it just kept coming to me that they were these horror games. There's a bunch of niche genres in horror, but survival horror is what a lot of it is called. So I was playing these games, and last year was just a big year in horror. A lot of games came out. There were some updates and remakes and long-awaited sequels that we saw. So I've just been I've always been attracted to those games. I don't get too scared. It's fun. I like darker themes. I can handle it, I suppose. I've always kind of liked the horror genre.
Yeah. So. Oh, braver than me. We did a show about horror movies last October for Halloween, and like just doing a radio show about horror movies made me feel scared. I'm such a baby. Well, Bryant, in a moment, we're going to hear some reporting that you did on this subject. But before we do, can you tell us a little bit about how you reported on this story in this region? Like, is there cool stuff going on in the world of video games and horror that is right around us?
Yeah. Well, the gaming scene in Vermont is getting bigger every day. There's a lot of, you know, with Champlain College, the students there, they have their esports program, and they have teams, they have clubs. You know, students are running these clubs, so you can find a lot of people playing different games. They do game jams where, you know, they're developing games, and you can play games that people are developing. So if you find the right people, you get online. A lot of it's online. You got to join a Discord. You got to watch on Twitch. But you can find it. There's a lot going on in Vermont when it comes to games.
And you went up to Montreal or talked to somebody in Montreal?
I talked to some people who had been going to Montreal. You know, people from out of state and Montreal will come to certain events here. So it's been going on for a while. It's not something new, but you got to be in the know.
All right. Well, let's all get in the know and take a listen to your reporting.
Thank you.
After a dazzling performance of I'm Just Ken from Ryan Gosling at the Oscars, we say goodbye to the cultural phenomenon that was Barbenheimer. A movie that was left out of the award show was the Super Mario Bros. Movie, which deprived us of a dramatic rendition of Jack Black's love ballad Peaches, which we hear now. But without awards, the movie still goes down in history as the highest-grossing video game movie of all time, at $1.36 billion in ticket sales. But a movie that had quiet success came from another video game. Five Nights at Freddy's.
Welcome to Freddy Fazbear's Pizzeria.
The series plays with an unsettling thought. What if the animatronic mascot Chuck E. Cheese wanted to harm your child?
Where fantasy and fun come to life.
Critics panned the film, but it was the highest-grossing horror film of the year, beating out updates to long-standing franchises like Saw and Scream, and new titles like Megan and Talk to Me.
Sometimes a video game will get so popular that the mainstream media has to address it.
That was Jenna Stieber, a video game journalist who's also entrenched in the world of horror.
A lot of happenings in the industry just go unremarked on unless it is being written about by a video game-specific imprint.
2023 was a standout year for horror in Hollywood. With 55 releases on the big screen and record numbers at the box office, the second highest grossing year the genre's ever seen. And horror took the spotlight on the video game scene as well, with remakes of legendary games like Resident Evil 4 and Dead Space, and the long-awaited sequel Alan Wake 2. Stieber says that traditional news outlets like the New York Times or Washington Post don't spend as much time covering video games like they do with other art forms.
You can trace that from Pac-Man to Fortnite. Like there will always be a game that's so big that it cannot be ignored anymore. But then there's also the chance that it will always be seen as a sort of a second class medium in the same way that horror has, I would say, largely for its whole existence.
Every human knows what fear is. Putting it in a safe space, like a video game or a movie or a book you're reading, is something that every human will be attracted to.
That was Dave Richard. He knows a thing or two about how fear can be a way to engage an audience as the senior creative director at Behavior Studios in Montreal, who developed the game Dead by Daylight. The 2016 multiplayer game plays like a giant horror movie mashup, featuring iconic villains you'd expect on the Mount Rushmore of horror, and the survivors in those stories as well.
In a horror story, there are only victims and monsters.
One of the latest characters featured is none other than Alan Wake, the titular character of a game that won Best Narrative, Best Art Direction, and Game Direction at the 2023 Game Awards.
Each license we got gave us a little bit more credibility. It's like a snowball effect.
But like some of the best horror movies out there, Dead by Daylight doesn't take itself too seriously, featuring a fictionalized version of Nicolas Cage as a playable character. I also spoke to Jade Moore from Champlain College. Jade is an undergrad studying creative media. She got hooked on Dead by Daylight after watching streamers play it on the online platform Twitch. I asked Jade that same question. Why torture yourself? Why play a game so scary?
It's actually funny. I despise horror. Like, I don't like watching scary movies. I hate playing scary games.
Although out of her comfort zone, Jade put her fear to the side.
It's like, okay, I'm gonna try it out.
In a game of Dead by Daylight, one person plays the villain and four people play survivors. Survivors can hear their hearts beating out of their chest as they run away from the villain who aims to offer their soul up to a cosmic being known as the Entity. In my conversation with Stieber, the topic of elevated horror or prestige horror came up, a framing of the emerging subgenre of arthouse films like Get Out, The Witch, or Hereditary, that tend to have audiences and critics discussing the social commentary more than your average monster movie or slasher flick. Dave Richard had some thoughts, too.
Horror is morphing and is trying something new. There's a good balance of the classics that we expect and also other sources that makes it original instead by its own to renew the experience.
And Behavior Interactive is trying something new too. After developing the DBD universe over 7 years, they've announced a single-player game called The Casting of Frank Stone, which will dive deeper into their original lore. At the end of the day, people will seek out the forms of entertainment that speak to them. A biographical film about historic events, social critique on our society, or a twisted tale of fiction full of jump scares. The most memorable titles stand out when they have rich storytelling we can relate to, which comes at no surprise.
Help! Help! Help!
What I'm left wondering is, did Nick Cage make it out safe?
Seriously! Help!
Someone should check on him.
Okay, I missed something somewhere along the way. How do I get out of this hell hole?
For Vermont Public, I'm Bryant Denton.
Well, if you are a video game enthusiast or play some of those games that Bryant, my colleague, was just reporting on, give us a call at 800-639-2211. You can also email us at vermontedition@vermontpublic.org. So, Bryant, please tell me more about what you like about the environment of one of these games, because to me it sounds pretty stressful.
Yeah, no, it is. It is stressful, and that... The first time you're playing one of those games, or me, I'm screaming. I'm jumping up out of my chair. I'm like, why am I doing this? But then once you when you come back to it, because you know in a video game you might die, you might have to you might have to come back and try again. It gets easier and it's more fun once you get past that initial hurdle of fear. And it's funny. Sometimes they're funny. It might be. It sounds kind of grim, but you can actually die in a funny way in a game. And I don't know. That's always something I've liked.
Yeah. Well, we just heard Nicolas Cage, and I know other celebrities like Keanu Reeves have lent his likeness and a voice to a game. Liam Neeson voiced a character in Fallout 3. It seems like celebrities are really starting to recognize the story and the craft and maybe the big opportunities for profit that come with video games.
Yeah, no, it's really coming together. There's a lot of voice actors who you can hear them in many games, and you know the show The Last of Us that came out last year. That was a big crossover where we saw not only voice actors who were in that game on the screen, but it was a success in many ways that they're translating a little bit better now, and Hollywood and the game industry, they're working closer. They always have been. There's always been people who, you know, voice actors who are doing all these games, and then you see them on a television show and you're like, wait, I recognize their voice somehow. That's always been happening, but now it's a little more in your face with actors and their likeness being put in games. There's a game called Death Stranding that has Norman Reedus and Mads Mikkelsen and a whole bunch of other cast, and they're more of those types of games are coming out. It's becoming more normal, I would say.
Well, let's go to the phones. We have a call from Brian in Montreal. Brian, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes, hi. Thanks for taking my call. It's great to have this subject covered in the media. I work for a game company in Montreal here. I've been developing games for over 30 years, different types of genres on different systems, and just seeing it evolve over the past three decades, becoming the blockbuster money-making entertainment platform that it is, and it's always nice to see what new challenges the industry brings.
Mm. Brian, can I ask what's the scene like in Montreal? Are there a lot of companies like the one that you work for in this area? Does it feel like a really fruitful ecosystem for game design and production?
It does. It does. Actually, that there are a few different colleges and universities here that will teach video game production as a way to introduce people that want to get into the industry. There's a place called Izar. They teach game design. They teach 3D modeling, different art packages. There's Sin Studio, which teaches concept art production for a game production, that is, and teaches you what the companies would be looking for in terms of how to present your work and what a typical production pipeline would run like.
Well, Brian, thank you so much for calling in. And in just a couple moments, we'll also hear from a professor at Champlain College here in Burlington that has also very well-developed program for many of the areas that Brian was just talking about that's going on in Montreal. Brian, to wrap up here, what's something about your reporting that surprised you, something that you learned that you didn't expect, or maybe a path that you want to go down in your future reporting on video games and the gaming industry?
Yeah. So When I began reporting on this, I did reach out to Champlain College to sort of see if I could work with some students, and I did end up working with who we heard in the report I had, Jade Moore. And when she told me that she wasn't really a horror fan, but Dead by Daylight was her favorite game, it was confounding. It was like, this is the game that is horror encapsulates the whole genre. Yeah. So I was just like, how do you end up playing this? So it was more thinking about, everyone has their own reasons about how they can play a game and why they're playing it and what makes it fun to them. So it's, I kind of want to explore that more and find out why people like what they like in this huge genre, this huge industry.
Well, so, for me, it's Mario Kart always and forever.
Well, that's a classic. That's a classic. That never goes away.
Vermont Public's Bryant Denton, thank you so much for your reporting and for talking with us about it.
Thank you. Thank you.
It takes a village to create a video game. From narrative designers to programmers to marketers, many, many people have to work together to build a successful game and get it out in the world. For the rest of the hour, we are going to look at the local pipelines into the world of video game production and esports. Now, our next guest knows all that it takes to develop a video game. Jesse Gagnon is a producer, narrative designer, and anthropologist who has worked for studios like Riot Games, where she helped grow the wildly popular game League of Legends. She's now the program director of game production management, game business, and publishing at Champlain College in Burlington. Jesse, welcome.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
We're so happy to have you. Now, tell us a little bit more first about working on League of Legends. I don't really play a lot of video games, but I know that game. It is huge.
Sure. Yeah. So, you know, I started at Riot Games in 2012, which, you know, hard to think about. I was employee number 220, I think. We were very small back then. The company rapidly grew into, you know, a couple thousand people. And it was a challenge working on League of Legends. The game grew faster than, you know, we had expected, and developing a game that's growing that quickly, that is, you know, 24/7 live, has to have a lot of hardware to run it, is quite the adventure. But yeah, I'm so glad I went on that adventure. I grew up in New Hampshire and ended up living in Japan for a couple of years before that, teaching English, and then Riot hired me, and the rest is history. I jumped the fence from anthropology into game production.
Wow. And I know the gaming industry, as you've described it, has changed so much over the years. Does it still feel in a way like a boys' club, or is that changing too?
It's changing. You know, I'm pretty happy to say that when I joined, the often cited statistic was that, you know, women were less than 10% of game developers. And over the years, you know, I've seen reports suggesting that women and non-binary, you know, non-cis male game developers has gone up to about 27%, which is really great and heartening. Obviously, we can get that number much higher. And, you know, that's actually why I turned to teaching. I really wanted to help increase diversity and opportunity in the industry. But yeah, it, you know, it's gotten better even just in the past 10 years. I've been so impressed with how much that has changed.
Well, let's add one more voice to the conversation here. Grant Peterson is the owner of the WNFC Esports Dojo in Essex Junction. It's a training center of sorts for kids and teens who play video games competitively. Grant, thanks so much for joining us.
Hi there.
So tell us a little bit about the history of the dojo.
Gosh, I moved to Vermont in December of 2020. And where I come from, it was Daytona Beach, Florida.
You did the opposite move,
right,
that a lot of people
most
here
people
do.
Moved south. I did not. So the fighting game scene is very, very strong down there. In fact, Daytona Beach is home to CEO, which stands for Community Effort Orlando. It started in Orlando, but had to move to Daytona's Ocean Center because it got so large. It is effectively, I would say at that point, was the second largest fighting game tournament on planet Earth. 6,000 or so people would descend during a long weekend. So I come from a strong scene of that. I grew up in the arcades. It was really kind of my thing. When I moved here, I noticed we didn't have a fighting game scene. I tried to find one. It was very, very slow going and a lot of digging to find nothing. So I decided to create one. And I got together with a couple of like-minded individuals and we kind of built this thing out. It started off as just a group of maybe five or six people just coming together every Wednesday. It was called the Wednesday Night Fight Club. And right after that, we got together with Champlain College because we needed a place to grow and kind of thrive. And Christian Conazal, the director of esports there, was really, really kind to us and gave us the place to do that. But the longer we were hosting weekly events, the more I started to realize that we weren't getting the kids that were started it at the same time I did. Like the best time to start anything, training in anything, is when you're a child. So
it's too late for me.
No, it's not too late. It's never too late ever. Like I could teach you and I could have you speaking our parlance probably within a week.
All right. We'll talk.
But I wanted to bring kids into it because when you break down what playing fighting games is all about, it's really, to a surface level, you're looking at two people fighting one another, but to a trained eye, you're watching two people fight themselves. It is, you're fighting your biases, you're fighting your patterns of behavior, you're fighting your predispositions. So there's a lot of self-analysis and self-reflection and self-improvement that takes place through the process of getting better. And that's something you can take and apply life-wide. So when I was like, okay, well, what do we do to help kids? What do we do to bring kids into this? My thought was to create an after-school program and a summer program. So that way you could bring those kids that were locked to their couch or not really doing, you know, socializing. You know, there's a lot of stuff online where you have the social connection, but it's not the same. It's not the same as trying to learn from someone who is literally next to you. And in the arcade, it was very dog-eat-dog sort of mentality. And I didn't want to replicate that. I wanted to give something with more structure and more positivity and more lessons of saying it's okay to embrace failure as a stepping stone to success. It's okay to struggle with something if it means you're getting stronger. And there's a very steel-sharpened-steel mentality, but yet it's very, very kind. And I want to put that in a more positive light. That way it's not just pressing buttons. Like there's something that you can gain from it.
Yeah. I want to dive into those like values that you're describing for just a moment with both you and Jesse Gagnon. Because you know, we started out this conversation talking about this genre of horror and also some of the violence that's inherent to a lot of video games. But then, you know, I hear you talking, Jesse, and you as well, Grant, about how powerful these communities of gamers can be. These core values of working together, teamwork, you know, building something together, developing skills over a long period of time. Those sound, you know, very wholesome and nurturing. So first, Jesse, let's start with you. I'm just curious what your thoughts are on this kind of like this dichotomy between, you know, some of like the violence and the horror of the games that might be played, but the joy and the camaraderie and the interpersonal skills that can be gained by playing them.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, there's a couple different flavors of this, right? On, you know, League of Legends, we always compare to any other sports team, right? You have to train a five-person team to be better at League of Legends. You work really hard together. You spend time practicing, you know, like you would on any other sports team. And, you know, you develop this really close sense of camaraderie and trust in one another and, you know, communicate about, hey, what could we have done better in that last match, right? And then in the community itself, you know, we had so many passionate fans who, even if they didn't play the game, maybe they watched Arcane, right? Or maybe they were huge into cosplay. We had this absolutely massive, you know, just absolutely wonderful community of cosplayers who continue to impress me with making costumes, and they would get together and have sewing sessions at PAX, which was just, as you said, it's really wholesome and wonderful. And some of the other flavors of this, you know, in the horror game community in particular, is you have these massive games like Dead by Daylight, or some of the more viral streamed games right now, you know, that are coming out, such as Lethal Company. Those players are coming together over a shared interest, and, you know, positive reinforcement in the community itself often creates such positive outcomes among those people. So I actually know a few people who met, God, years and years ago now on World of Warcraft, who, you know, are married, for example. So I think this phenomenon's been growing for quite some time, and it's very interesting to see how folks have made communities and friendships and these other, you know, really positive spaces thanks to video games, despite, you know, whether or not they have violence in the content, right?
Well, listeners, if you have thoughts on this conversation, we would love to include you as well. 800-639-2211 is our number. Grant, I'm curious if you have to have conversations any times with parents of kids about the types of games you're playing, or kind of talking through those values that you know, are kind of imbuing in your work at the dojo. Do you ever get some, like, some parents coming to you being like, I didn't grow up doing these. I don't know what the scene is like.
All the time.
Yeah. What are those conversations like?
Productive.
Yeah.
Very productive. I think once most parents, I mean, as a father of two myself, it's really important to have your children engaged in something that means something. It's got to be meaningful. You don't just play something to play something. You're there to get something from it. You're there to learn something and grow a skill set. That's why the dojo actually has tech skills. We actually teach other stuff as well to try to touch off on things that are, we try to teach things that are connected to gaming. So things like webcasting, video game design, media design, things like video editing, things like that, stuff that kids get into. They see, like, oh, I love my YouTubers, but okay, well, how do they do that?
Yeah.
I want to teach you how to do that, because there's a lot of things that you learn that can cross over. But then whenever we look at fighting games themselves, what I teach, it's more like a martial art than anything else. Hmm. It's more, there's a discipline, there's a focus, there's a dedication to the betterment of self. And that is such a valuable trait to have, because it can really set yourself up for success in profound ways. The one thing I tell parents all the time, and this is much to the chagrin of children, is that we don't play shooters. And as much as I appreciate team games like MOBAs, things like League of Legends, I don't teach anything that involves a team, because I want this to be more self-focused and more self-driven. I want them to come together as a community in our dojo, but it's a individualized practice. Mm. And I don't ever want to play shooters, because I never want to answer the question, why have you taught my child to shoot another child?
Mm.
That's not, it, just the optics of that alone is not something I want to face.
Hmm.
So I keep things kind of limited. We do branch out into things like, we'll play Mario Maker, and we'll look at how levels are designed, and we'll try to say, okay, what makes things fun? What makes things challenging? Can you understand the nature of challenge? And kids really respond to that.
Yeah.
I love watching them create things, build things. And then I love taking them back to fighting games and saying, okay, can you be creative in a limited box? Because
yeah.
Most creatives really only thrive when they have to break out of constraints.
Mm.
So show me how your approach is creative. Show me how you can use the tools, a limited set of tools, to both simultaneously present and solve problems.
Mm.
And how do you master your own anxieties in the moment?
Mm. Well, Jesse, I'm curious for your thoughts here on something that Grant just said about not playing shooters, about playing lots of different kinds of games with mm-hmm. the kids that he works with. Are there certain types of games that folks are, you know, coming to your program, you particularly interested in? Any trends towards or away certain types of games, including like the games that involve shooting or you know, types of violence that parents might not want their kids to be playing?
Sure. Yeah. So, you know, there's a couple different things I'd say going on that often match some of our more industry-based trends. Mm-hmm. So, for example, we know Fortnite is extremely popular. We see an increase in teams wanting to make more fantasy-based or science fiction-based shooters. So I have a senior team right now making a game called Sync. But you're playing as robots and you're shooting other robots, right? So, you know, it's not based in realism. I haven't seen sort of a more realism-grounded shooter in my time working here, and I think that matches a lot of what's, you know, more popular in the industry right now. So, you know, that's what we would call our T for teen rated range in terms of it's fantasy violence, right? It's not, you know, based in the more realistic look of COD, Call of Duty, for example. Mm-hmm. So we see that. Last year I had actually a horror game, which was great. I was super excited to see one. So that was Kessler Syndrome, which was atmospheric space horror. You played an astronaut stranded on a space station. You had to figure out, you know, how to survive, how to get through this.
I feel like I've had that actual nightmare.
Oh, God. It was pretty scary. I kept telling them if I loaded it up on my, you know, VR headset, it would have been absolutely claustrophobic inducing. But yeah, you know, I think we also get a lot of interest in roguelikes and roguelites right now. Those are very popular in the industry as well, mm-hmm. right? But, you know, it's tough because we also have to teach students to balance what they're capable of making in a, you know, a team of 16 people over the course of a year, right? Mm-hmm. There's only so much you can make in that amount of time. And making a game is very challenging. It's part of why we have them make games 3 years in a row in this interdisciplinary, you know, studio format, because we know if they don't practice that loop over and over, you know, they won't get that better understanding of how difficult it actually is to make a game in a team and come together, you know, like a real game studio. And it's why we mirror studio practices, because we want them to basically show up day one on whatever job they get to and say, oh, yeah, OK, you do this the same way we did at college. I'm ready to, you know, be an associate level employee here and make games. Mm. So,
well, you brought up some popular games, and we just got a couple of emails in from listeners telling us about the games that they like to play. Brett in Brookline, Vermont writes, I was a huge fan of older horror games, and one of my favorites was a game called Doom. Years later, yeah. I replaced that with the Resident Evil series. Jason from Montreal writes, I've been a fan of since I was 15, and now I am 46, and I used to play Sonic, they're right. I cherish the games, but I don't play Sonic games anymore. The plush toys, though, are incredible. About 10 or 15 years ago, I was on a car ride with my dad, and we ended up in San Francisco. I knew there was a Sega building there, but it was closed. I was deeply disappointed. Thanks, Jason, for writing in. Grant, there was a big local tournament here this past weekend, right?
Sure.
Can you tell us about it?
We've been putting together tournaments for a number of months. We usually do our schedule runs that we do weekly, because again, Wednesday Night Fight Club, we always run weekly Wednesdays. And then we have Saturdays at Champlain as well. And normally twice a month at Champlain, we do tournaments. Smaller, more locally focused, but it's always kind of a nice way to see who stacks up on top of the pile in particular games. We decided to make something a bit larger. Burlington Beer Company actually reached out to us and asked us to host an event. And I said, sure. So we decided to host a Tekken 8 tournament there. And marketed it and set everything up. Luckily, we had a couple of people in the community to help help furnish and bolster the prize package for the top finishers. And we were able to get a lot of people to come out and play. My target, the baseline for things to have been, you know, to justify its own existence was 20 competitors. And my ambitious goal was 40. I'm like, all right, we can double that. That's rookie numbers. We can get that up. And we ended up getting 47 with 7 disqualified from either not showing up or not being able to make it. And that included players from New York, Boston, and Montreal.
Nice.
And not only that, but we also have all of our Vermont FGC fighting game community. But we also had our dojo students, and our dojo students are sponsored. So it's part of their curriculum to step in and challenge themselves and to learn and to kind of face down the pressure of that moment and to kind of learn more about yourself and how you react to things when things seem, you know, wow, there's people cheering behind me. I'm on stage. Like, how do I feel? And between that and about, you know, 100 plus spectators, people have been making claims that it's been the largest esports event that Vermont's ever seen. And my only answer to that is yet. So stay tuned on that front. But it was a really fantastic event, and I have so much undying gratitude for the guys at BB Co. and Champlain Esports. All of the people that worked with us, all of our volunteer staff, people in our community are just absolute diamonds, and I would not be able to get this done without them.
Yeah. Well, a reminder, listeners, that we are streaming this show today on Twitch. We have some folks following along there. We got a comment from a Twitch user called Banana Fangs, who writes, Voices of the Void is a great game. I've been all about co-op games since the pandemic, and it's a great way to connect with friends that live out of state. Well, thanks for following us along on Twitch. And Jesse, you know, we just heard from Grant about some big ambitions for bringing more gamers together in the state of Vermont. What are you seeing growing about the local or regional scene?
Yeah, so, gosh, I've been here 2 years now. It was great to move back to New England, and I really love being in Burlington. You know, the thing that I think really blew me away when I got here is we have 623 students enrolled in our game programs here at Champlain College. And that's a tremendous amount of development and technical resource for the state of Vermont on graduation. And so I've been encouraging more of them to get involved in indie game development. We do already have a couple game studios founded here in Burlington by alumni, such as Weathered Sweater. And, you know, the grants that have been coming through for technology in Vermont also make it a really good opportunity space to continue game development in Vermont, particularly post-graduation. So I've also been talking to some other studios and trying to convince them to start up some development here in Vermont, because it's much cheaper than California, for example, to make a game here. But nothing too concrete on that yet. I'll let you know if I ever get one of them to sign up for it.
Well, it sounds like there's a lot of exciting stuff going on right now. And thanks as well to everybody who's following on Twitch. Catfish Blues writes, I love playing Harvest Moon, Fishing Resort, and A Small Hike. Scenic games with fishing that help cure my fix when it's too cold to go fishing. Well, it's never too cold to go fishing in Vermont, according to lots of folks here. So if you're not here now, you should come on up and visit, and maybe visit the dojo or Champlain College while you're at it. Now, there are lots of auxiliary ways to be involved in esports, from handling cameras to facilitating live production of these competitions, like Grant, I know you've been doing. First, Jesse, could you talk about some of the ways in which students can get involved outside of actually, you know, sitting down and competing?
Yeah, absolutely. So for esports in particular, you know, we provide them with all the skills to run a stream, do shout casting, which is when you host a live match, right? And you actually call the play-by-plays that are being made. Much of that actually came from learnings from ESPN that were incorporated into studios like Riot Games for League of Legends, so they can learn all those best practices. We also make sure our students get a really firm grounding in understanding what content creation needs in terms of how do you create a cohesive brand, right? How do you talk about yourself as a developer and how do you talk about, you know, yourself on a team, right? All the best practices that sort of go into feed into that. And then also, how do you interface with social media? How do you host positive conversations? How do you moderate those conversations so that they don't trend into, you know, toxic places? And as a former player behavior producer in particular on League of Legends, I have a lot of experience in that regard. So we make sure that they're getting a really well-rounded education so that, you know, even if they decide not to go into games or esports, for example, they can still go into nearly any tech company, social media, they can go into software, pretty much anywhere here in Vermont or beyond, and they're fully equipped to hit the ground running on day one.
And are these some of the skills that you're also teaching or talking about with the kids that come to the dojo?
The idea that what we work with is to give them the rudimentary version of that, to give them sort of the basics and allow them to kind of explore and grow. The idea is that we prepare them with enough exposure and experience with those tools. So that way, when they decide to move into a collegiate aspiration, they can get things like scholarships. So at that point, you know, we've got, rather than introducing them to, say, webcasting or video production or things of that nature when they're 15, 16 years old, get them go ahead and exposed to it at 9, 10. So that way, by the time they're 15, 16, they're already thinking about building portfolio work that'll start to get them higher education aspirations or even something that can get them a job. So what we do when we're talking about our partnership with Champlain, and I happen to know Jesse somewhat well, she was one of our most instrumental pieces of last year's summer program. And I still can't thank you enough for that, Jesse. I just can't.
You're so welcome. It was great.
the idea is that to build sort of an on-ramp into those programs. So that way it kind of galvanizes a symbiosis between the two. So I personally believe in the power of education. I think smarter people are always better people. So the more you know, the more you're able to do. The kids that learn what they learn at the dojo, they kind of choose a track and they're able to explore those technologies and those tools. And it's really less of a deliverables mandated method. Normally you get into college, it's, you know, how you have deliverables, you have semesters, there are certain things you need to get done because that's preparing you for the professional environment. Whereas when I'm starting to teach kids this stuff here, there are milestones that we want to hit. There's things that we kind of want to, I want them to feel like they have progress and that they're making progress towards a goal. But I want to let them be more exploratory because I think play is so important, especially at that age. I think the one thing I could probably do to shoot myself in the foot would be to bring them out of school and say, okay, cool, welcome to another school. You know, like there's nothing that's going to kill your interest in your dreams quicker than that. So if I allow you to kind of explore this cool stuff and you're like, okay, cool, but I want to learn how to do this and I want to see if I want to try this. All right, this is a great place for you to build really janky things and have and just try and fail and just have fun with it. Like just treat it like Play-Doh. You make a mess and that's fine. You can make a mess. Because that's what you're here to do. But every single time you clean up that mess and do it again, the iterative process of what you're doing, you become more and more capable. and you build better and better things. And learning fighting games is the same way. You strengthen yourself in a practice. And if I can help build a track towards them achieving their future dreams, then I've done my job.
Hmm. Well, it sounds like such a close-knit community in a very close-knit state. It's great to hear that you and Jesse are working together on so many of these projects. And thank you to everybody who's been following along on Twitch. This has been a bit of an experiment for us. And please continue to comment if you'd like. We've gotten a couple more comments as you were talking, Grant, about favorite games. Selly Petra writes, Anatomy. Oh, Selly. You know Selly?
Oh, I know Petra too well.
Anatomy is a scary and unsettling look into how we as people treat houses and what happens when you leave them alone. Very spooky. Another user with a username I don't think I can pronounce writes, Champlain College game design class of 2009 here. Neat to see this featured on Vermont Edition. Still looking for an industry job too. Happy to hear there are indie studios in Vermont. Very cool. This has been a really interesting conversation. I have learned a ton. Grant Patterson, I apologize. I've been messing up your name this whole show. Grant Patterson. it's been a pleasure to have you on. You run the WNFC Esports Dojo in Essex Junction. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
We've also been joined this hour by Jesse Gagnon, a producer, narrative designer, and anthropologist, as well as a program director at Champlain College in Burlington. Jesse, thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks for having me. And I just want to say, if anyone wants to check out Champlain's Twitch show May 3rd, we're going to be streaming our senior show with all our senior games. So stay tuned for that.